Carlos, you're going to go ahead and start the introductions. I'm going to pass it on to you, and the floor is yours. Thank you very much, Carlos.
Sure thing. Okay, I want to make sure I have the right setup. So one second here. Let me get this thing out of the way.
What are you trying to do, Max?
Yeah, I'm good.
Presentation mode right there. Perfect.
Cool. All right. So thank you, Rick, for the introduction for the community. It's always good to see you all. Thank you, everybody, for joining. It's always good to give back. It's something that I really enjoy. I know Rick for quite some time, and he's been my coach for many years, and we go a long time, you know, working together. So it's always great to see you all and working with you all guys. So I'm going to start a little bit about me. My name is Carlos Santofimio. I work for a company called GFT. I'm a program delivery manager. Today is my 3 months with GFT, and this is why I'm wearing my t-shirt. I'm very happy with them. I'm from Colombia. I live with my wife. She's the love of my life. She's very sweet, and you know, we do a lot of fun things together. I have two brothers. One of my brothers is one of the speakers, Oki. We call him Oki, but it's Oscar is his name. And also he has two nephews, and I have two nephews. He has two sons, and also we have one more brother. A little bit about me. You can probably see it on my profile, but I've been doing IT leadership for more than 20 years, working for pretty big companies. I also have all the Agile certifications that some of you may know, like Scrum Master for SAFe and in the Product Owner. Also did a little bit of design thinking and fintech education on a couple of universities, and have an MBA from UM and a master's in MIS. One fun thing about my brother and I is that we used to do experiments when we were kids. So when we were at home, on one of those experiments, I burned my brother, but you can see that he's fine now. That was a long time ago, but that was something fun. So about my brother, he's an HR manager for a company called Sutherland. He lives in Barranquilla. He has two sons. And he's been doing HR since I can remember. So it's been, I think, 16 years, if I'm not mistaken. Recently, for the last 6 years, he's been doing attrition mitigation for this company. And he's also going to be one of the speakers. We also have Amy. And I know Amy from one of my good friends, Matthew. And Amy, thank you for joining us. We're going to go through the session, and then either in the middle or at the end, I do have a question for you, and everyone is more than welcome to ask. So I think that's enough about us. Everybody has the LinkedIn, so I'm going to get started. This is kind of the agenda. I just did the first part. Then we have a couple of videos. I'm going to ask some questions, and then the meat and potatoes is in the middle with Oki, and then we'll go through Q&A. So let's start with this. And this is a little personal, because you see it's a key change, but actually I do have this keychain with me right here. I bought it a long time ago when I went to the Kennedy Space Center. And then that phrase caught my attention, you know, failure is not an option. So we're gonna see what it means in the context of NASA. And I'm sure that you probably can relate to some of that. So let's just get started on that. All right, so let me start with the video, and then we'll ask a couple of questions.
We sometimes forget, in light of everything that happened, that the primary objectives of the Apollo 13 mission were to explore the Frau Maurer Highlands, to gather geological specimens, and to enhance our knowledge of the lunar landscape. But as we all know, other lessons were learned. Lessons that would make every future spaceflight safer. Beyond the Earth's atmosphere, the crew settled into a series of routine tasks and system checks as they coasted peacefully through space. On the 13th of April, right after the crew had conducted a live TV broadcast, disaster struck. The explosion on the service module irrevocably changed the course of this mission. To conserve power, the crew had to shut down all of the ship's systems. They now faced freezing temperatures, depleting oxygen, and carbon dioxide poisoning.
The angle of entry into the atmosphere is a very small angle, only about 2 degrees, so it has to be controlled very
quickly. Failure was not an option. The astronauts had to rely on their Speedmaster chronographs to time the mid-course engine burns that ensured their safe re-entry into the Earth's atmosphere. It worked perfectly, and the capsule splashed down on target in the South Pacific Ocean. The mission was dubbed a successful failure. It demonstrated what could be achieved through teamwork and ingenuity. For its role in enhancing the probability of mission success and flight safety of the Apollo missions, Omega was presented the coveted Silver Snoopy Award in October of 1970. To the astronauts and to all of us, Snoopy's slogan reminds us of the importance of believing in our goals, our dreams, and above all, in ourselves.
All right, so for me, this is inspiring for teamwork. Agile is all about teamwork. I know there's a little commercial about Omega there. They're nice watches, but I do have a question for everyone. I cannot see the screen, so maybe some of you can help me with some of the answers. But what inspires you? For me, this is special because sometimes we hear from projects that, you know, failure is not an option. But I do feel that if you're thinking about saving lives, that's the case. But if you're thinking about experimenting and trying new things, you should be able to fail and try again, and because that's how you learn. So the question for everyone is, what inspires you? What do you think is something that comes to mind when you think about inspiration for what you do? So I'm not sure if we got any answers.
So do you want to put them in the chat, or is
The chat is fine. And if so, you can.
So Joe, maybe you can look to see who's actually putting anything on the chat, or if you want to just unmute. This is a smaller group, so if they want to unmute themselves and just ask, what inspires you? That's a great question.
Making a positive impact.
I think for me it's a little bit about helping people. This really what inspires me. When you're working with teams, is something that I really take pride on. So we can probably move on a little bit, and I know we're gonna have Q&A just to move things a little bit, unless there's anyone that wants to share.
No. You know, I just thought of something. A good inspiration, really, is coming to these meetups, being able to help out and training. And I'm not just trying to say that. It really is. It's good. It's a good thing, right? Because we get to bounce ideas off. We get to learn. We get to, you know, have discussions. We get to have fun, right? And it gives us a playground to practice some of the things that we like to do. Rick and his team have been a great asset and has helped me through my journey. And so thanks for all that. Thank you guys.
Cool. So let's move on to the next one. 1 second. This one is from a company called ADP. I'm sure most of you know this company. They did a research, so I'm not gonna go through the details. So I do have a question at the end. So let's just watch it real quick. It should be quick also.
Take two.
Sorry. So let me tell you about Barbara. Barbara, it turns out, is somebody that you're really going to want to know because she is, in fact, the most engaged employee in the world. I know this because as head of the ADP Research Institute, we've just finished this 19-country study. We really wanted to know how high is engagement in different countries and what drives it. But as part of the research, we sliced the data. And we found there's one worker in the world who's more engaged than anyone else. Her name, Barbara. That's a joke. That's not really her name. She's a composite. But when you slice the data, she's a manager or team leader in professional services. She's been with her company 5 years or more. She works on a team. She has a main job and she's also got kind of a side gig that she does. She's a blogger. Oh, she works at home 80% of the time. When she goes into an office, it happens to be the headquarters of her firm. Her commute, in case you're interested, 31 minutes to 60 minutes. She's been with a company, but have I said that already? She's married, but she doesn't have any kids. She does have a pet though, a python by the name of, apparently, Gregory. So that's Barbara. Listen, we don't really know that she's got a pet. Well, we know she's got a pet. We don't know that the pet is a python, and we can't be sure that the python's name is Gregory. But everything else prior to that is true. As it happens, women are slightly more engaged than men. As it happens, professional service is slightly more engaging than it is to work in construction, let's say. But of all the things that we know about Barbara, by far the single most powerful one is that she is a member of a team.
A team, of course, is a group of people who've agreed to work together. We like to walk through the world as though people are the same as one another. But you look around you and you see the first thing that strikes you about humanity is we're all different from one another. The best leaders know that the idiosyncrasy of every person is a wonderful thing to be drawn out, that the weirdness of a human being is the best bit. How do you knit weirdness together in the service of something useful? The answer is this splendid piece of technology, thousands of years old, called the team.
If you say you're part of a team, if you feel part of a team, you are twice as likely to be fully engaged at work.
Barbara's part of the gig economy as well, with one full-time job and one side hustle. Are there any lessons there for the world of work?
The two most compelling reasons for people to be gig workers are, number one, that it gives them a greater opportunity to be in control of their lives. 25% of all gig workers around the world give themselves the same title. President. And the second most powerful reason,
the full-time job gives us predictability and stability. The gig job gives us a chance to do something that matters to us.
To do what you love. Some stability here and then some flexibility, creativity there is something that we could all learn from.
We learned Barbara's a remote worker, but that might be a little bit surprising because we think of remote workers being somehow separate. The data says that remote workers who feel like they are part of a team are actually more engaged than co-located workers who come to the office today who feel that they are part of a team.
Clearly, there's some value to working at home and having the creativity and the flexibility that comes with that, the control of your own schedule.
Remote and feeling part of a team trumps co-located and feeling like part of a team. The question is, how can I get more Barbaras?
At the moment, the levels of engagement are not high at all. 15.8% of people are fully engaged at work. That means 85% of us around the world are just coming to work. So our challenge really is, once we get people to come in and join our companies, how do we get them engaged? How do we get them productive?
We would all like to have the world's most engaged person working on our team, to which the answer is you do already. You just have to help them express that and step into that. It's not a question of choosing the right person. There's nothing about Barbara that's inherently engaged. There is a set of things in her environment that each of us could help create at work that brings out the best in Barbara. Do you feel part of a team? Does the team bring out the best in you? That's how you get more Barbaras.
One thing that is curious about this video is that it was, I think it was recorded in 2019, and they, you saw the percentages, but from my research and my brother is gonna go through some of that, I believe that the percentage is higher as far as how people feel about their engagement at work. So I do have a question for everyone again on this one. Is do you think that you're doing something that matters to you at work? Is how, if anyone has anything that they want to share on that question?
I mean, I can share this. This is Rick. So that we coach others and that we help others, I think that's very rewarding. And I think they appreciate it. And when we go in there with an open mindset, with empathy and all that, I think it really brightens, you know, my day. So I get energy from seeing people that, you know, that are, you know, getting the best out of their career, getting the best out of their workplace. So I truly believe that, you know, that I feel a very sense of pride in the stuff that I do. It's very humbling when it's not about the limelight. It's not about, you know, it's about them, you know, growing and sharing. I think that's very humbling for me to be doing that as a career. Like, this is something you dream of. It's something that you would be doing even if you weren't getting paid. You know, it's that humbling feeling that we get every day, you know. So for me, it's very rewarding.
Yeah. And you're doing quite well with that, Rick. Thank you for doing that. I'm always learn from you. Anyone else? No. If not, we'll go at the end. I think now it's the part from my brother. Okay, you ready?
Hey.
Yeah. So, hello, please.
Before he gets started, I'm concerned about the way early on you mentioned that you burned him, and that was just very, like, it seemed like you were, you said you were, I actually have it recorded, and you said you were kind of, like, that was fun.
Yeah, so, I can explain you.
I think you indicate that it was fun. So I just want to make sure that he got back at you. And if you could at least share that you got him back for something, please tell me that you did something back to him to kind of break the ice. That would be a good one. Okay, if you can help us with that. Thank you.
Yeah, I'm waiting for the next time I see him in order to pay back. But right now I'm doing pretty good. And it was quite an experience. We were young kids. We were teenagers trying to have fun, making some experiments with weird things out of whatever different ingredients we have. And somehow we put fire on it, and the fire came to my food, and I get a little bit burned. But, well, it went pretty good. It took us like an hour to solve the situation. But, well, I'm doing pretty good. But it's kind of the family memories that we all shared together. And it's so nice to see that even in difficult times, we can go and we still be family and we can still make it together. So you make a good point. I'm going to pay back somehow. Yep. Okay, so please, everybody, feel free to make as many questions as you want. You can use the chat or you can unmute the microphones. And we're going to talk about something that is pretty important, because we've been talking about the mission of the Apollo 13. We're talking about inspiration. But there is something that we kind of fail about, and it's our people. Because when we talk about people, we talk about dreams, we talk about futures, we talk about family, and this is the kind of mission where failure is not an option. And I want you to think about the attrition as something that is taking place in your company, in your family, in your region, in our countries, in every place. People is not willing to stay. And we need to find out the way to understand why it's going on and what can we do about it. Sometimes it's called attrition. Sometimes it's called turnover. Sometimes it's called rotation. However you call it, it's happening. So can we go to the next one, please? Retention must start the first time we meet somebody. Don't wait for the person to leave you a resignation letter saying he's going to another company, or he's leaving your house, or he's no longer be your husband or wife to take a decision and to try to do something. Retention retention must be a daily thing with the people you love and the people you work with, okay? And retention strengthens the whole team. This is not only a business thing. This is not only a laboral thing. This is life. We need the people we need together, and we want the people we love to still be with us. The quote you see over here, over there, "I'll belong because I feel I belong," is something that my nine-year-old son, Nicolas, said 2 weeks ago. We're moving to a new city. We are going to a new school. He's getting a new teachers and a new classmates and new things. And I say, okay, how are you doing? Do you like it in here? Do you think we're going to be here for a long time? How do you like it? And he come to me, and he's 9 years old, and he says, you know what? I'll feel that I'm going to be here for a long time because I feel I'm part of something. And this retention and HR business and people-related things is all about giving the people the opportunity that they feel and they perceive and they think they belong somewhere. If you are part of a family, that I think you are, because we all are, you need your family members to feel they belong somewhere besides the last name you have. They belong to a project. They belong to a mission. They need something to think about because they want to be part of something. Especially with these new generations we have the millennials, we have the centennials, and now we're going to start having the pandemial. I don't know how the name is going to be, but people think they are not safe anymore in whatever situation they are, because 9/11 changed the whole thing, and the pandemic, the COVID-19, coronials, thank you, changed the whole thing. People want to live experiences because they don't longer think we're going to live forever. The past generation used to look for an established thing, spend the rest of my life in this company doing this, plan my life in a 10, 20, 40 years. But right now, people is thinking about today, tomorrow, and no longer than 6 to 9 months. And it's a reality. So we need to give them something that they want to be part of. Okay. Can we go to the next one, please? What is attrition? And please feel free to write or to ask whatever you want about attrition. But this is a very easy definition, a process where employees leave their jobs for reasons such as retirement, resignation, transfers, etc. We're going to talk about my best friends. Thank you. I know sometimes attrition is my last name. When you work in the kind of business that I sometimes I'm Oscar attrition, because people is leaving this kind of company and this life attrition. But yeah, that's true. Attrition is my best friend. Whatever is happening, people is leaving, and we need to understand why. And sometimes retention is an option that we need to think about. Okay. Can we go to the next one, please? When we talk about attrition, people say, okay, what's the formula in my company? We do it this way. How do you do it in your company? But we need to start thinking besides the company and beyond the formula. It's easy. You have a number of people and some of that people is leaving. That's the attrition you have. So the formula is not important. The reasons are very important. Right? We have four different type of attrition. One of the most important ones is the voluntary one. Please go to the next one. Voluntary is, I take the decision to leave this company because I don't like my manager anymore. I don't want the money that I'm receiving anymore. I think it's my time to make a break and go to another country and do whatever. I won the lottery or whatever, and I just want to leave this company. If you think about this way, when the person put your resignation letter, there is no so many things to do because he already took the decision. You can try to make a retention effort. You can try to make a salary adjustment. You can try to, okay, you know why? What are you thinking? A little bit, go in a vacation period. I'll do this for you. I'll do that. But at the end of the day, he's already broken in the relationship with the company because he's thinking about leaving. something already happened. There are things that you can do at that moment, but you miss a lot of situations where you can actually have done something different. Lack of appreciation, lack of recognition. You can name whatever thing what people is living, but at the end of the day, they are living. The involuntary attrition is the one related to those people that you can actually fire from the company. You decide that for so many reasons, you don't want them to be part of a company, or in different local regulation in different countries, we have different reasons why people can actually stop working in your company. Let's say the age, in some countries, they have the age for retirement. Let's say some kind of disability, in some countries they have that. Let's say some kind of, I don't know, if I go to jail, I can no longer work for this company. So depending on the local regulation, there are reasons why people involuntarily leave the company. It's something that you have to take into account, because at the end of the day, people is leaving. But the one you have to try to do something about is the voluntary one. Also, just for information, some companies put the internal promotions of the internal change of roles as a an attrition, but people are still in the company and they're growing, but they take that number because they need to replace the person that is going to a different role in that company. And something that is starting to take place in our geographies and in our companies is a demographic attrition. People with the same interest, or let's say employees with the same group or the same, way of thinking, decides to leave the company because of the things, of the thoughts they have, okay? If you have that, please take a good attention on what is happening. Maybe some kind of discrimination and misconduct that might be behind that, some kind of, disruption, some kind of aggression that this specific group is having, and you need to start taking a look at that. Okay, I don't know if you have questions right here, or please let go to the next one. The cost of attrition, I want one of you to say how much does it cost for your company when one person leaves the company?
I'll speak, and pleasure to meet you, Oscar. Pleasure to be here, everyone. I don't know the exact cost, but I know that it takes time to train another employee, to get the specifics right. So I can imagine it's very costly and time consuming.
Yeah, you are totally right. Thank you for being part of this, and thank you for answering. The cost is kind of hard to define, but what we have found is around 6 to 9 months of salary that you are going to lose, because you have to retain a new person. You have to hire a new person, all the staffing process behind that, then all the training that you need to do to this person that is new, and also all the knowledge that the person that used to be in the role is taking with him or with her. So the cost is pretty high, and also the reputation of a company, because if you see that 20% of 30% or 50% of the people is leaving this company, you say, okay, I don't want to be part of this. And something, at least 100 Goodwin coins. Yeah, that's pretty good. It's a lot of money. And at the end of the day, you need to understand that this is way more than money. Money is always important because we are in business. But this is people. There are dreams. There are desires. There are family that are being impacted for something that took this person to leave a company, okay? So 6 to 9 months, depending on the person, that's the average we have, or salary that we're gonna lose if a person loses your company. So start making the math, guys. Start thinking how much money you're losing for the people that left your company 30 days ago, 40 days ago, or something like that, okay? Can we go to the next one, please? Attrition reasons. You can name as many as you want. Better career opportunities, family reasons. Maybe I'm in the COVID situation, so I don't want to go to a job because it's risk for me. Or maybe the company decided this and I'm not pretty okay with that. Or maybe my manager is not doing what is good. Or there are so many reasons. And the coach goes, hops in, okay, thank you. depending on what's happening, you need to start doing something. And the strategy changes depending on what is the driver that is making the people leave the company. But as we're going to see later, it's not only money what makes the people leave. There is a lot of books and research that says that around 75 to 80% of the reasons why people leave the company is their leaders. So we need to work in the leadership. We need to work a lot in what is people actually getting from the leaders and how much chance do they have to say what they think and to feel free to say, okay, you know what? The company is doing this and I'm not pretty good with that. So it's not only money. It's what people is making the people get engaged about the company. Okay, can we go to the next one? Current situation. There are so many things happening. Of course, there is a lot of uncertainty of what's going to happen, but people need to know what is happening in the company. We can go to the current situation, and I want you to please think about what's the attrition rate that you have in your company right now? What's the attrition rate that you may have in your community right now? My friend left the house, or my family went to another country, or my neighbor is no longer living there. What's the current situation? And think about your company, think about your life, think about your family, because we're going to talk about life, okay? Can we go to the next one? These are numbers. The world is changing, and people are not willing to stay. Students are leaving early, the education. This is Europe's number. 9.9% of students are leaving before they end their student the school. The second might be funny, but it touched a lot of people. Every 13 seconds, there is a divorce in America. It means that there are 2 million divorces per year. And you say, okay, I'm still married. I don't want to be divorced, but this is a number that you need to start thinking about, because if I'm getting divorced, that is gonna be impacting the way I see my company and the possible performance that I'm gonna have right now. That's the number about divorces, yeah. And that's only America. Think about in a global business, in a global way, how much people is getting divorced. And the last one is about labor numbers. 20% of people left the company in 2019. And we are not talking about COVID. We are not talking about pandemic. This is a number prior pandemic. Pandemic made this worse. But 20% means that in 5 years, you're going to have to hire 100% of all your company again and again. And it's time that you not want to spend. And it's a lot of resources that you don't want to be using, okay? So depending on the industry, this number can go to a 35% in a month or can go all the way to a 1 or 2% per year. So every industry has its own challenge, but in an average of 20%, it means that there is something we need to do about it, okay? I don't know if there is a question here that you may want to ask, if you want to put it in the chat, or you can also unmute the microphone. Please go to the next one. We see the numbers here, 10 million of job openings in the US the last day of June. That sounds ridiculous, but it's true. High rose to 6.7 million and total separation edged to 5.6 million. That's a lot of people. That's a lot of people that dream to grow in the company where they used to be, and they're no longer in the company where their dreams were. Something we're doing and the mission is failing. There is something we need to do. Okay, thank you, Amy. That's a good number. 35% of tech professional plan to look for a new role in the second half of 2021. That's a number for you guys. That's a number for your companies. That's something that you need to be aware of and be prepared of, because maybe the 35% of your people is no longer be there for the second half of 2021. Okay? Can we go to the next one, please? These are the reasons from different research. And you can see here compensation, 23%, but management and leadership are 81%. And it's the decision you took, is how you implement the decision, is the communication you have in your daily basis with your company that make the people not be aware of what is happening in your company, okay? Alignment, collaboration, teamwork, company confidence, there are so many different reasons, but whatever is happening, especially in your daily job, is something that you need to start working on, okay? Can we go to the next one, please? I want you to spend 1 minute thinking, what about you? How do you feel today in the life you're living? Because this is pretty much about life. If you spend 8 to 10 to 12 hours in a daily basis in your job, it's about life. So what about you? Do you want to keep doing what you're doing for the rest of your life? Do you actually know what you're doing? And do you know why you're doing what you're doing in the daily in your daily basis? So I want you to spend 1 minute about this. What about you? Do you like it in there? And what makes you stay is also important, because when we talk about attrition, we not only talk about what people is leaving, but also what people is staying and what it's gonna make us the most of the people keen being in the company, okay? So what about you guys? How do you feel about the work you're doing in your daily basis? I know this is personal. If you don't want to answer in the chat or in the microphone, I still want you to please think about that. No, we need to answer that. Okay. Can we go to the next one, please? It's all about being part of something. It's all about a mission. It's all about focus. It's all about knowing how to get where I actually want to be. It's about purpose, okay? Looking to work currently, I would comment, okay? Do you like what you do right now? Do you know what you do? There is a reason why you do what you do, because sometimes I don't have any idea what's the reason why I go in a daily basis to a place to do something that most of the time I don't like. Or maybe most of the time I love what I'm doing, but I don't have any idea what's the purpose of that. Maybe I think it's getting money for a board of executive. Maybe I think it's trying to reach my dreams through this work. But we need to start thinking, why are people is coming in a daily basis to do whatever they are doing in our company? Do you know what motivates your people? The person that works for you, what's his family or her family? Who does he live with? What are his dreams? What's the purpose? Remember the mission we talked at the beginning of the session about the Apollo 13? They had a purpose, but at some time, it was all about life of the astronauts, and they need to secure their life no matter what. This is also about that. It's the life of the people you work with. It's about the life of yourself, because you are part of a company, whatever they're doing good or they can do better, okay? Why are you doing what you are doing? Okay, please, let's go to the next one. Here is a video, and I want you to please take very good care of the details. And please play the video, but take good care of the details of the video. And I hope you enjoy it.
I'm gonna play it, okay.
Thank you. Okay, so if you took, if you saw the video, and I think you did, what time did he actually woke up every night? 10 o'clock at night. Did you see that?
Yes.
He's the lifeguard. Thank you. He's the lifeguard of a manufacturing fabric of, I don't know how to say this in English, maniquis. How do you say that, Carly? Maniquis, mm-hmm. Something like that. Well, the
mannequin.
The things you saw.
Mannequin.
Mannequins. Thank you, mannequins. So someone has to do that job. Someone has to take care of the mannequins while it's night and everybody's sleeping. So he had not a very easy job, and he was by himself. And he took advantage of that. While everybody was sleeping, while everybody was doing something different, he took advantage of that and make it worth it. He made it worth it. Worth it. So if you see, he changed the whole thing with just the desire of doing it. And he made every day of the people that he didn't even knew because he was in the night shift better by making the mannequins dancing, by doing like that. And this is a tradition they have in Spain. This is an Spanish video when they have a lottery and all the team members of a company buy the ticket to win the lottery and they won the lottery. So they make him feel they belong somewhere. At the end of the day, they win the lottery as a team, and they include him, and all of them change the thing. If you saw the last part of the video, there is a mannequin who gives him the prize, but everybody was waiting him at the night shift at 12 o'clock in the night for him to come there and say, okay, you're part of this. We made it together. And this is what the whole presentation is all about. Make the people feel they're part of something. They belong somewhere. Even if you are in the less easy job, if you are by yourself, you can make the mannequins dance. You can make changes for the rest of the people. You can make something for them to be part of something. And I don't know if you want to say something about the video, if you want to say something about what's the impression you have about what we've been talking until now. There's a comment here. Now I feel in my job, I feel alone where I'm at and on my team, but there is so much fear of the cuts that are coming up. Okay, thank you for the comments. And I see a lot of comments about people willing to go to a different role, to a different company. Maybe some of you are already seeking for a different job. And this is also for you to give a new chance, a different opportunity, and to make it worth it for you. You have the opportunity to make the mannequins dance. I don't know if I'm saying it right, but if I'm not, I'm sorry. But this is your opportunity to make them dance for the other people and also for you. It's your opportunity to make yourself feel proud and belong somewhere, okay? Can we go to the next one, please?
Yeah. Oh, sorry. There you go.
Okay. Talent development and retention. Not everyone can do what they love. Some people just need a job and willing to have, okay, thank you. Thank you for that comment, Mark. I really appreciate that. As we told you before, 6 to 9 months of employee total salary is one of the causes of attrition. And 75% of the reasons are way more than just a salary. They can be preventable in the daily basis. How make the people be part of something? The engagement activities. Engagement is not only the fun activity when we get together and we have a good time. Engagement is being part of something. It's being involved in something. When you are engaged, you are part of something. When you are engaged, and I can say it happened to you maybe some time ago, you flew to another city to meet a person you love. If you are engaged, you take the decision to do whatever it takes to do something that is important for you. And that's the kind of attrition that's the kind of retention we need to have, that people can actually go the extra mile. When I talk about my son, he loves his new school so much that he's actually trying to do better because he wants to join the soccer team. So he's trying to learn more about soccer. And I think I used to be pretty good at soccer until I met him. He's giving the extra mile because he wants to be part of that. If you feel you belong somewhere, you'll do whatever it takes to do the best for your team, for your family, for your company, for the people you are really you care of. Okay? Can we go to the next one, please? Retention. There are some tips over here, but as I told you, this is not a final effort. When a person says, I'm leaving to another company or I'm no longer in this company, there is no many things to do. We have to try to do something at that point too, but the retention starts the first day in the onboarding process. You need that the first face you show to the person is the best one. Your staffing process has to be perfect because they want to be part of that. The way you attract people has to be perfect in order for them to say, okay, I want to be part of that. I want to be part of that company. And then the staffing process has to be successful. So they're going to say, okay, I was pretty good treated. And I really like the way the person talks to me, the transparency they show to me, and how the company is shown through the person and the people that represents the company, okay? Engagement is key, but remember, engagement is not only the fun activities. Engagement is you are part of something, and it's how you engage the person you love and you want to spend the rest of your life with. It's how you engage your son to be next to you no matter how hard he's dealing with the life. Engage is how you give the people the opportunity to follow you for whatever you are showing, okay? That's engagement. Feel part of something. Let them feel they belong. How do resignations affect others' attitudes about looking elsewhere? Yeah, that is true. If I see that 10 of my coworkers are leaving, I say, okay, something has happened. And thank you for that question. Something might be going on because people is leaving. Maybe I don't know why, I don't know what, but something might be happening. So that's a good point. Resignation is contagious. Maybe I'm going to another company and I go there and I say, okay, you know what? I'm doing pretty good here. Please come to me. And there is a lot of reference things that are going on in different industries. But yeah, people can start thinking why the people is leaving my company. Maybe there is something that I'm not seeing about that I maybe start looking for. Emotional salary, given experiences, is not only about salary, economic, and compensation. Given emotions, given plans, given projects that they could be part of, given reasons to stay, make the monarchies dance as the people did in the video, okay? There are things that money cannot buy. Remember that commercial that credit card used to have? Yeah, for everything else, use credit card, but there are things that money cannot buy. And people today is pretty much aware of that. And every time they're getting more aware of that, there are things that money cannot buy, okay? Development, they want to grow. They don't want to spend the rest of their life doing what they're doing right now. They want to go to a next level. They all want to be influencers. They all want to be Instagrammers or things like that. They all want to be CEOs in the next 5 years, okay? We need to give them opportunities to make the world worth it, okay? So development is growth, is internal growth, is project, is things that they can actually do. Two-way feedback. People wants to say something. People wants to be heard. And sometimes I tell you, okay, you need to do this. You're not doing this pretty good. And you need to improve in this. Or congratulations, you're doing this pretty good. Recognition is also important. Think about tomorrow you come to your house after a very hard day of work, and you come and you say to your husband or your wife or your son, you know what? I did a pretty good job today. And my manager saw that, and he gave me this small recognition saying I was the employee of the day. That cost nothing, but that means a lot for the people. If I get a ticket to my son saying that I did pretty good, he's going to give me the best hug that I can actually receive. And that's something that's worth it. Recognitions, two-way feedback, given the opportunity to say how they feel about what is going on, okay? And know your employees. Talk to them. Focus group is a very good initiative. One-to-one feedback sessions. How are you feeling? Talk to them in a daily basis, not only about work, what's your favorite team, what's your favorite sport, how do you like about life. Whatever is important for them has to be a priority for you, because if you give them what they are looking for, they're going to spend more time in your company. Can we go to the next one, please? This is pretty much what I had to say about retention and about attrition. Thank you for giving us the opportunity. I'm going to give it now to Amy or to if you guys have many questions or something to say. But think about this. Love generates energy. Love is forever. How can we save the world all together? And if there is something you can actually think we can do to help you, please let us know. Okay? Thank you for this opportunity. And think about your people as the main mission you have in your company that you cannot fail. Okay? Have a good one, guys.
So Oscar, a quick question for you. So the idea of, so in Agile, we do a lot of retrospects, right? Lessons learned. And one of the key things that we mentioned in this is creating a safe environment where people could speak up and share their thoughts, right? So when you have leaders that kind of go in there and then they're, it makes it difficult for you to speak up. So I think that's key in everything you mentioned there is really key in the work that we do on a daily basis. I think that's really, really good that you showcase that. But the understanding that you as a boss, you immediately have a threatening approach, right? Because you are their boss and they have to please you. You got to make sure you're setting an environment for them to have those uncomfortable conversations and be, you know, able to do that. So thank you very much for sharing that piece. I really, really enjoyed that. So I think we're moving now to Amy, right? Any questions? Or first, before anyone else has any questions that they want to ask?
Yeah, I think you touched on it a little bit, but I just think, like, as part of this, you know, when you're trying to engage people and keep them, just having a high emotional intelligence, IQ, will really help as well. Like some of the things Natalie was saying, like she's kind of in a tough spot, right? The first thing I'd want to do is, you know, find out more, you know, how can we reach out to her and help with her situation? You know, how can we make that better for her? How can we give her the tools to help her through her next chapter, her next initiative? Because she's thinking, you know, hey, I have a rough time here. So maybe, you know, something I got to think about.
Yeah, if there's something you can actually think we can help you with, just let us know, and we can contact you or you can contact us to understand what's going on, and we're more than happy to try to support whatever is going in your specific case. And please feel free to touch base with us, and of course, we're going to support. And that is also important, that the people have that environment that they can actually say, this is happening to me, and we have the resources or the way to answer and do what the employees needs. Some kind, for example, in this pandemic situation, some companies have some kind of psychological support, of medical support, of how to deal with this situation, because I don't know how to go with this. And depending on the specific case, there are so many things that we can actually do. But the most important is make them feel that whatever is happening to them is important for us. So thank you. Thank you for that point too.
I think Mark has his hand up. Mark?
I do. I wanted to know what your advice is should you have people who are, for some reason or other, toxic and kind of like bringing other staff down. Can you talk about that and maybe some good tricks or whatever you got?
Okay. If you already identify the person that is doing that, go right to him, okay? Can I talk to you? What's going on? Try to make him or her talk in order to understand why is he saying or doing whatever he is doing or saying. But go to the problem, because you don't want that to affect our, as one of you are saying before, contagious the rest of the people. So try to talk with him. Okay, what's going on? What is make you so unhappy about this company? And if there is something that you can actually resolve that now, you can do it. But sometimes what you can find is that at the end of the day, they are saying things that are not true and need to be identified. So any case is different, but my advice would be try to identify the problem by talking with the person. In that way, the rest of the people are going to see that they are important for you. So that would be my advice. Try to reach what's going on, what's really going on behind the comments that the person is being toxic about. I don't know, it may be Rick or one of the team members want to say something about that.
Yeah, I can jump in too, because I just had a situation with my team, right? I manage about 45 people in South Florida. And Oscar, I agree with you 100%. You need to know what's going on, right? And if we don't understand, we may be making an assumption we don't know. Then once you do understand what's going on, you have a decision to make as a leader. It's, do you want that person on the team or do you not want that person on the team? And then you need to go about the path, whether you're going to be trying to manage somebody out or trying to coach them and get them to where you need them to be. And that's one of the hardest decisions, because some people have potential And some people just don't want it, you know, or some people just, it's not the right environment fit. And it can be, that's the hard part of being a leader, is trying to uncover the why they're acting that way, and then make that decision if it's something you want to coach, or if it's going to cause more harm than good to the team morale. It's tough, but we are seeing people leave left and right because of one bad apple, and it can be toxic for an environment.
Totally agree.
Yeah.
That's right, Amy. If I may, I have a question for Amy.
Yeah.
For me, it's, you know, with all this stuff going on, and we know kind of what's going on in the world, how do you keep people motivated? How do you keep your team motivated? You know, we hear news about crazy races from different companies, even PTOs, sometimes even unlimited PTOs. So we hear all these things because companies are struggling to get folks, and I would like to get some input on how do you keep your team motivated, how do you keep on doing that.
Yeah, we're definitely, it's hard, right? Especially when most companies are in a remote state. You know, when you hire somebody and bring them on board digitally, what we were talking about earlier, Oscar, about making them feel part of the team and part of that engages them and empowers them and makes them want to be. But it's hard to do that digitally. You don't know, you no longer have the let's grab beers at 4 o'clock and kind of do that kind of stuff that really glue a team together. And that's the struggle a lot of companies are having. And that's, it's not the only reason, but it does definitely add to why we're seeing so much turnover. You know, in our studies, 80% of IT leaders have experienced turnover in 2021. I mean, that is a ridiculous stat considering, you know, obviously the pandemic that did impact stuff, but we thought things were coming back pretty well this year. And we're seeing people start to reevaluate where they're at and say, okay, do I really want to do this? Like we were talking about earlier, is this what I want to do as a career? Is this where I want to be long-term? And employees are starting to have those thoughts and how companies and managers responded to the pandemic and some companies deciding to go back on site is just causing a lot of uncertainty. And so companies and managers specifically to kind of retain and kind of engage and motivate your team, it's hard. It really is a challenge. Couple things that we've done that have worked really well. We use Microsoft Teams for our communication for our team. And we started just a congratulatory chat with the entire team. And it literally is just a celebration of milestones or things that people do well, or hey, shout out, you really handled this project extremely well. And it's not just about gaining revenue or doing something, you know, massive. We're celebrating the little wins on a day-to-day basis, and kind of even some of those new hires that might be with my team 4 months, pointing something out that they're doing well as they're kind of learning and growing has been great, because they're like, I did it. Like, and I know that might kind of sound a little cheesy, but kind of having a leader appreciate what you're doing and the work you're putting in when you sit at home all day by yourself can actually go a long way. You don't have to use smiley faces and exclamation points and everything, but just a word, I think, from a leader of appreciation can go a long way. We are seeing increases in salaries. That's definitely something that companies are doing. I would, if you're going to do something similar to that, I would recommend having some sort of career path discussion or understanding where people want to go and kind of align that with your company's goals. We're seeing unlimited PTO offerings. We're seeing fully remote. We're seeing even 4-day work weeks. A lot of that stuff is coming, I guess, more in more volume this year than it ever before, because we're having a struggle with retention. I mean, there's over 10 million open jobs in the US. Everyone is struggling to hire right now. And I mean, we see it every day. Like I'll go to the restaurant of my block and they're like, listen, we apologize. Like we appreciate you being patient. We just can't find enough workers right now. So it's every industry is being impacted. And so it's something that I think companies are really having to evaluate. And I agree with what you said, Joe, about going in with emotional IQ. You have to like be sympathetic or empathetic, I should say, to the situations that are going on. And if we don't have that cap on and we just manage like we used to manage pre-pandemic, you're just going to lose people left and right. And they're not going to feel part of the team. And they're like, Oscar, like you said, they're going to want to leave.
Yep,
unfortunately. Absolutely. I hope that helped.
Yeah, I would add one more thing, because there's a lot of extrinsic motivations.
which are very, but intrinsic motivation is another interesting factor here. And I think, Oscar, when you were doing your presentation, remember the theme, it was all about belonging to a team. So in Agile, we do something that really cements that interaction. It's called, core values. Like, what values? You want to get common denominators to say you're a team because you have these core values. And that kind of helps them actually establish that foundation. But of course, if you're not paying them adequately, they're gone. You know, there's factors, there's minimum stuff that you need to do. But that is one that I think organizations are now slowly starting to get the picture. Hey, you got to set the environment for them to succeed. And that first criteria of being a team is one of those things. Autonomy, purpose, and mastery. Those are the three elements that actually helps that engagement score goes up. All right, Carlos, did you have another question on your side, sir? Sorry.
No, I'm good. I was going to say that I completely agree. It's something that in Agile, for me, it's a mindset. And many times, people don't understand that because Agile has many, many flavors. But they're really core things, like Rick mentioned, that really drives all this teamwork. Because at the end of the day, just like, my brother mentioned and Amy mentioned and we saw in the videos, it's about teams. And we're also kind of a team in here. We're going to help Natalie, but, it's about that. It's about how do you work together? What matters to you? What makes you tick and go to work every day? And that's why I agree with all you guys, what you were saying. So yeah.
Okay. Time-wise, guys, sorry, go ahead, Amy.
No, Rick, I was just going to say one last thing. I know there was mentioned earlier about, sometimes you don't have the, privilege to be able to choose your job, right? We all have families. We need to pay our bills. I need to, afford to be able to live in my house. And so I would just encourage people that because of the market the way it is, putting feelers out right now is not a bad thing. So kind of just seeing what's out there and seeing if there are options that could, yes, you have to, do your job and kind of pay your bills and stuff. But I would encourage anybody that's thinking about looking, now is a good time to look because we don't know how long this market's going to last. And it is a very good market for talent.
And we highly recommend Amy. If there's anything that you guys need, please reach out to her directly. So from a meetup, guys, I want to make sure, do we have any other questions before we kind of summarize the ending of this event? Any other questions? Please put it on the chat or unmute yourself. I hope there's not too much noise here on this side.